ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। So today we'll be hearing from the 8th canto, 19th chapter, text 13. Everyone can repeat after me.
Vairanubandha etavan amrutyoriha dehinam ajnana prabhavo manyu अहम मनोपब्रूमितः
वैरानु अनुबंध एनिमिटी एतवान सो ग्रेट अमृत्यो अप टू द पॉइंट ऑफ डेथ इहा इन दिस देहिनाम of persons to involved in the bodily conception of life. Ajnana prabhava, because of the great influence of ignorance. Manyu, anger. Ahammana, by egotism. Upramhita, expanded. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace S.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada ki. Translation. Hiranyakasipu's anger against Lord Vishnu persisted until death. Other people in the bodily concept of life maintain anger only because of false ego and great influence of ignorance. Purport. Generally speaking, even though the conditioned soul is angry, his anger is not perpetual but temporary. It is due to the influence of ignorance. Hiranyakasipu, however, maintained his enmity and his anger against Lord Vishnu until the point of death. He never forgot his vengeful attitudes towards Vishnu for having killed his brother, Hiranyaksha. Others in the body the concept of life are angry at the enemies, but not at Lord Vishnu. Hiranyakasipu, however, was everlastingly angry. He was angry not only because of false prestige, but also because of continuous enmity towards Vishnu. Everyone can repeat. Hiranyakasipu's anger against Lord Vishnu persisted until his death. Other people in the bodily concept of life maintain anger only because of false ego and the great influence of ignorance.
Namam Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Srimati Bhakti Vedanta Swami Tinamine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Sunyavadi Prashchata Desatarine Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaur Bhaktavinda. Everyone, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare.
So question, how many people know how many times you breathe in 1 minute? How many breaths do you have in a minute?
12 to 16?
Pretty close. Okay, anyone else?
How many?
He sang 12 to 16 times in a minute.
In a minute?
Yeah.
It depends if you play him or dunk or not.
Right.
If you play him or dunk.
Right, yeah. You're pretty close. The Google says 12 to 20 minutes per, 20 times per minute, and 17 to 30,000 times in a day. Right? Depending on how fit you are. And I was listening to my Guru Maharaj's lecture yesterday, and he said that, you know, death is only half a breath away from you. It's only half a breath away from us, right? Why he explains that? You don't know. When the death comes, you might take the last breath in and you may not be able to breathe out. Or it may be the other way around. You may breathe out and you may not breathe anymore, right? So therefore, like our temple president Panchakara says, it's very important that we remain healthy. Every day, every meeting, he actually reminds us. And when I heard my Guru Maharaj's lecture yesterday, I was thinking of how you're reminding us that every breath counts. Every breath counts. You know? Our breath is extremely important. You know? And with every breath, what counts is whether we are connected to Krishna in a divine way, or we have enmity in a demoniac way. In the 16th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, the divine and demoniac are compared. Krishna is explaining. We'll look at those few slokas in a few minutes. But it's very, very important that we try and understand where we stand, because we don't have the power of Hiranyakasipu. We don't have the power of Hiranyaksa. We are not great devotees like Bali Maharaj. But what we can understand is that we have a great opportunity. There is a great opportunity for us. Because look at this. Even though Bali Maharaj and Prahlad Maharaj, they came in the dynasty or in the families of demons, you know, because they used their higher intelligence. You know, they could have easily followed what the other demons were doing, but they used their higher intelligence to follow the principles of religion, because they could see that by following certain principles of religion, they had a better opportunity to conquer, in terms of in place of Bali Maharaj, that he could conquer Indra's position. And on the contrary, Prahlad Maharaj was far, far more intelligent, because he was fortunate enough to hear the pastimes from Narad Muni himself. So he could understand that there's nothing greater than being a devotee of Krishna. So he followed in those footsteps under all circumstances. So many challenges came his way, but he did not give in. Krishna says, Tesam Satata Yuktanam Bhajatam Priti Purvakatam Dadami Bodhi Yogam Tam Tenamam Upayantite. Right? Dadami Bodhi Yogam Tam. Who does he give that intelligence to? To the one who is always connected to him. To the one who is always surrendered to him. To the one who is always remembering him. And to the one, like Prabhupada would say, is preaching is the essence, one who is always preaching the glories of the Lord and his devotees. So Prahlad Maharaj was in that, you know, position, you know. And even though Prahlad Maharaj and Bali Maharaj are born in demon families, look, they became Mahajans. Out of the 12 Mahajans, these are the only two Mahajans who come from the same dynasty. And they come from the demoniac dynasty. Yet, because they used their higher intelligence and they followed the principles of religion, They follow the signs of Krishna consciousness. They got elevated to such a high position. So when Prabhupada says that it doesn't matter which background you come from or which family you are born in, you know, if you simply take to these four regulative principles, if you follow the science that he has given us, then we are also eligible. The way I look at it is there's two great souls from the demon dynasty. But look at the dynasty that Srila Prabhupada has given us. Look at the dynasty he has given us, that like in every corner, every nook, in every city, in every country, there are devotees. And there's so many sincere devotees out there who are preaching. So many devotees who are out there, they have understood that it is better to be like Haridas than to be like Indra. Indra can get agitated, but Haridas cannot get agitated. Indra has a very powerful position. He is the king of the demigods. Yet Haridas has no other position other than that he simply surrendered to Krishna as a sincere, honest devotee, and he is consistently chanting the holy name of the Lord. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Vamandev, he didn't have to come. You know, Krishna is saying, Aham Sarvasya Prabhu. Everything is coming from him. He didn't have to come and beg from Bali Maharaj. But look at the humble position he takes. Why? He wants to bring a win-win situation between Indra and Bali Maharaj. Conflicts are always there between them, demigods and the demons, the non-stop conflicts. We find that there are conflicts all over the world between the countries. We find these conflicts sometimes between the temples also. There are 20 temples in Delhi now. Who draws the line where who's allowed to go and preach? So this is natural. So we have to use higher intelligence. Krishna, in the form of Vamandev, is using his higher intelligence very wisely. He comes to Bali Maharaj and is glorifying his ancestry so nicely. Very intelligently, because he is presetting the scene. He knows that Sukracharya is aware of who he is, and Sukracharya will try and do everything possible to stop Bali Maharaj from surrendering. Therefore, he goes to the extent of glorifying Hiranyaksha. He also glorifies Hiranyakasipu. See the art of preaching. So sometimes when we are out on the field, we have to remember how Prabhupada preached. And how do we remember how Prabhupada preached under all different circumstances? It's by listening to his lectures, by reading his books. He wanted us to read his books at least 3 times. And nowadays with the technology, it's not so difficult. You can listen on the one-eyed guru that you carry with you all day long. There is no tricks required there. Just press the button and you can listen to Prabhupada morning, afternoon, evening. When you're getting ready in the morning, listen to Prabhupada for 10 minutes. There is no excuse saying that I don't have time or I'm rushed. Then when you take prasadam at lunchtime, because you don't have time, that's your mental consciousness. So then you listen to Prabhupada's lecture while you're taking prasadam. So at least your consciousness is connected to Krishna and prasadam, which are none different, and at the same time you're listening to Prabhupada, and at least intake one point that you can use through the day. Before you take your dinner, or when you take your dinner, or when you're going to sleep. How many of you can actually sincerely say that when I go to sleep, before I hit the pillow, I'm knocked out? Why do I use this example? Because one grihastha approached Srila Prabhupada and they say, Prabhupada, it's very difficult. It's very difficult for couples to fall asleep. And Prabhupada said, That's because there is so much ignorance factor. There is so much maya. You are not preaching enough in the daytime. You should be preaching from morning till night so intensively, so seriously, that by the time you come to the bed, you should fall asleep before you hit the pillow. If you can do that consistently and you find that that's what's happening, then you know you're pretty close to following Srila Prabhupada's instructions. But preaching, okay? So in this way, Vaman Dev is very intelligently, in a way, sometimes people say that he was cheating Bali Maharaj, you know. But of course, we know Krishna is best at everything, you know. Nobody can be a greater cheater than him. And because he has the cheating propensity, we also inherit a minute propensity of cheating, right? Right? Where does it come from otherwise? It's coming from Krishna. However, we have to be very cautious. Krishna is using this propensity to bring a win-win situation. Generally, as individuals, as individual devotees, as individual humans, we have a tendency to use the cheating propensity to satisfy our false ego. You know? So we must avoid that. Are we using this situation or this propensity to please Guru and Gauranga? Is it going to be pleasing to Guru and Gauranga? Or is it going to be only for the satisfaction of my ego? It's a very simple thumb rule. There is no chemical formulas required. So when Vaman Dev is very nicely glorifying Bali Maharaj and his pastimes and his activities, and then he's glorifying all his ancestors, and then when he asks for the three steps, Bali Maharaj is very easily surrendering. However, now Sukracharya is trying to put out all the obstacles, he's trying to give all the great reasonings, you know, why Bali Maharaj should not surrender. He's even telling him, listen, this is not an ordinary dwarf boy. He's come to take everything away from you. But Bali Maharaj understands, he's saying, if this is Lord Vishnu, then he is the supreme. So by surrendering to him, I will get the best. I'll get more than what even Indra can give me in his position, or what I can get in Indra's position. You know? So that's why he is able to surrender. That's why he's able to surrender. You know. So once you surrender to Krishna, then you experience, even in our spiritual life, in our spiritual activities day to day, we experience so many situations, and sometimes the situations are so great, you know, so grave also. Like in Bhaktivedanta Manor, they were trying to close the temple down. And who was trying to close the temple down? The government. The government was full out to close us down. They started at local level and went to national level. The Prime Minister got involved and they wanted to close our temple down. I'll elaborate on that a little while later. In Russia, the devotees were put in dungeons. They were put underground. If you are too serious, they would lock you up away in a small hole in the ground and with a metal cage on the top. But they had faith in Krishna. They did not stop chanting. In France, Belgium, Germany, in the early days, there were so many obstacles. They were trying to stop our movement. They were trying to debar us. They wanted us to stop completely. Just like Hiranyakasipu, these people were persisting so seriously any which way to stop us from preaching. But because the devotees had faith in Krishna, devotees had faith in Srila Prabhupada, devotees had faith in the system, they persisted. Like in France, after many years, I don't know, 15, 20 years, they said, okay, you guys actually are not eligible to be a charity, so now you have to pay so much taxes for the past so many years. That was the formula they worked out, that by doing that, they would be able to close us down, because then we wouldn't have the money, so they could take our castle away, they could take our temple away. They took the temple away, they took the castle away. And then they put it on auction. They said, whoever can beat the best price can get the castle. The devotees from Europe very intelligently figured out how they were going to save that castle, and they formed another community, another group, which was non-ISKCON. They came together, and when the auction took place, they went there. There was one Christian leader who wanted to make sure that it did not come back to the devotees. So he, instead of coming himself, asked his representative, his agent, to come and bid. And he told him, bid, bid and bid, make sure you win. But he said, if it goes beyond a certain amount, then call me before you go any further, because I need to know who you're bidding against. So they were bidding, and our supporters were bidding, you know, devotees in guise, right? So they were bidding, and they got to that stage. And when he got to that stage, this person went to call his master. And while he was calling his master, the person who was doing the sales, he said, going, 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 one time, going, 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 two times. Finally, he said three times, and our congregation got the castle back. And then it was rented back to ISKCON. Even today, that treaty works. Faith in Krishna is essential. Whatever we're doing, you know, follow the regulatory principles, be sincere. Here, Prabhupada is explaining that it's very important in the previous chapters that Bali Maharaj was so successful because he followed religious principles, you know. So we have also principles that Srila Prabhupada has given us, and we should follow that sincerely. Four regulative principles, eating prasadam only, preaching, so on and so forth. You know? We have a nice long list. There is no time to get bored. There is no time to waste. Right? In other words, there is no time for maya. In England also we had a similar situation, and we were thinking, how can we win this battle? It is against the government of England. And there was two people, actually three people, one sannyasi, one temple president, and I was his assistant. We decided that we will follow the principle that Arjun was asked to follow, that we fight the battle and leave the results to Krishna. At least that much faith we should have. So we had to instill this into the community, that we must have faith in Krishna. So initially, when we announced that we're going to fight the British government, there was many devotees, many congregation up in arms. What are you guys doing? How can you fight the government of England? Are you crazy? But we stuck to one principle, and that was, you know, Sradhavan Bhajate Yomam. We have faith in Krishna. We pray to him and depend upon him, and we should fight. At least if we fought and we lost the battle, then we know we tried our best. But if we just give in like that, then there is always going to be regret in our lives. That battle went on for 11 years. How many years? 11 years. You know, we went through so many austerities, so much propaganda, so much fighting, so much anxiety, unlimited anxiety. As the battle grew, it became more and more tougher, and there was more and more concerns and more doubts, and more people saying, we told you not to fight, we told you not to fight. See now, you spend $1 million, pounds now, now it's £2 million, now it's £3 million, you're throwing the money away. One time, we had the opportunity to meet the Prime Minister of England, that was the Iron Lady Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher, and we were told to come to New Zealand House. It's a house where 3,000 people can get together. It's like 2,670 people can get together. So one of our congregation devotees, a big time supporter, he had planned to have a Diwali celebrations, and he told us that you please come. Bring a Bhagavad Gita, and he told us exactly what to say to her, write it, make a package and give it to her. We did that, And we went into this crowd. It was so crowded, and we were pushed into the one side somehow or another. And this all karmic people dressed tie suit, you know. And we waited an hour and a half like that. And suddenly the lights went out in the hall, and there was a balcony up there. And suddenly we see that some VVIP dignitaries are there, and also the Prime Minister standing there. They give their speeches and they go away. The lights go off in the balcony and the lights come on in the hall. And we are wondering what we're going to do now, because she's come and she's gone. We came, we could not give her the Bhagavad Gita, and we could not give her our petition. So Khandari Prabhu and myself, we decided we'll wait for another half an hour or so, and hopefully meet one of the brothers who would arrange the event and ask what to do. But to our surprise, like 15 or 20 minutes later, the Prime Minister is coming through the door, and just like we have one door here and the other door on the other side, you can imagine equal size hall on the other side, and she's coming right through, and we can see she's coming through and she's heading through the exit door, and we are stuck somewhere there behind 1,000 people. It would not be appropriate for us to, you know, bulldoze like we do in India, you know. So we were standing there in dilemma. Krishna, what do we do? You know? And she had like 20 SOS soldiers with guns and everything, and she's just waving and walking like a, you know, typical robotic move. And to our surprise, when she came halfway through and say where our president is standing, suddenly she made a left turn. The guards made a left turn, and the Prime Minister came to us. She came right, they brought her right to where we were, everyone up on the stairs. And then I was able to give her a Bhagavad Gita. First I had to shake hands with her. That's what I was told to do, shake hands with her, instead of doing that. And then I gave her a Bhagavad Gita, and I gave her a package, and I had to just inform her that we are also your children, we are also citizens of this country. And as a mother of this country and a Prime Minister of this country, we just wanted her support to make sure that our rights in the mother of democracy is not taken away. She smiled and she said a few words and she walked away. It's not a small thing, you know. When we have faith in Krishna and we are fighting, Krishna will put you through so much anxiety before he gives you the results that you deserve. If everything is easy come, then we will not build our faith. The more tapasya we perform, the more sincere endeavor we do in our preaching, you know, strategies, the more sincerely, you know, we give ourselves to the preaching movement, then you will see amazing results coming through, things that you have never expected or imagined that this will happen. You know? The Prime Minister had to actually walk where we were instead of us going to where she was standing. You know? This was the arrangement done by them. At least that's what they thought, but the way the devotees say it is that because of our faith in fighting for Krishna's temple and Krishna's palace, Krishna made all the arrangement for us. Before she came and took the Bhagavad Gita from us, nobody wanted to know us. After she left, everyone wanted to come and see us. We were stuck there for like more than 2 hours, and we were talking, and Akhandari kept giving me the cards. I was putting all that business cards. Somebody was president of this country, somebody was prime minister of that country, African country, European countries. We were amazed, so many people came. They just wanted to know who we were. Initially, we looked like aliens to them, but the only person the Prime Minister came and spoke to and shook hands was with the aliens from Krishna consciousness. Right? So, that's how it works. We have to take this very seriously. This moment, this process, everything Srila Prabhupada has given us is very unique. It's beyond this material world. Material world is down there, but spiritual world is up here. We are up there already. We are so fortunate that Prabhupada has already given us this dynasty where there are so many Bali Maharajis, there are so many Prahlad Maharajis, and there are so many Mahajans in disguise. You know? So when we meet each other, don't undermine anyone because of the position. You know, we all come to this moment. We don't know tomorrow who's going to, you know, rise above the platform that we cannot conceive. No? Right? Like the other day, we give sannyas to Vrindavan Chandra Das Goswami, right? He was Namata devotee, now he's a sannyasi. And he's all blissful. He wants to go out and preach everywhere. No? He wants our Namata group to grow. This morning he came to the office and said, right, now we have to do so much more work to do. You know, the energy comes up. And yet, previously, including myself, I have to be honest, we were all seeing him as a humble devotee. He is actually a very, very humble person, personality. So we were all seeing him as a very humble person, you know. And we were paying obeisance to each other, but paying obeisance to each other yesterday and today, there was different kind of energy flowing. You know, that energy was flowing so much, and everyone was gathering around, you know, to ask questions. So we should remember, death is only half a breath away. Krishna is giving us so much. You're taking in 550 liters of oxygen every day. If you went to Nayati Hospital or any other Apollo Hospital, you would be paying 10,000 rupees a day for that much oxygen that you're taking free of charge. Krishna is giving it to us. He's giving us so much more. That is just an example of oxygen. Krishna wants us to go back home so much more than we can even think of ourselves being selfish that we want to go back home. You know? We're trying. To some extent, we're all trying. We were not trying as hard as Krishna is trying for us. He's going out of his way again and again and again. He tries in so many different ways. He's giving so many pastimes, so many leelas with the different devotees, with the different demons, just so that we can realize that we also have a great opportunity, an opportunity that should not be missed, an opportunity that should be taken seriously. We never miss an opportunity to take Mahaprasadam or three times a day Prasadam. So why miss the opportunity to go back home, back to Godhead? That's how I feel. Any questions or comments? Yeah, with the Prime Minister, it's very interesting. Look at the PR efficiency of the Prime Minister's office. 10 o'clock at night, we are giving her a Bhagavad Gita and a package. Next morning, 7 o'clock, I was just coming from the car park to go to deity greetings, and this guy is coming on a bike. And where is he from? 10 Downing Street. 10 Downing Street is where the Prime Minister lives. And he came with an envelope. In the envelope, it said, "Thank you very much for the very well illustrated copy of Bhagavad Gita. And your matter will be looked into." Signed, Margaret Thatcher, Prime Minister of United Kingdom. You know? 7 o'clock in the morning, just literally like 9 hours later. This is how our PR should be. That if somebody comes and gives a donation, we should go out of our way to receive it, thank them on the spot, and thank them before 24 hours are up. She arranged for us, for myself and Gopichand Hinduja. Gopichand Hinduja is the second brother of the Hinduja Foundation. And he called me one morning and said, "Today, be at my office by 4 o'clock because at 5 o'clock, we have an appointment with Ted Heath." Ted Heath was the previous Prime Minister and he was the mentor to Margaret Thatcher. So when we went to his house, his residence, there was a round table and three of us were sitting, and there was two cups of tea and a cup of milk. I knew where I had to sit. And then he told us in confidence that, look, as it is, the Prime Minister cannot announce right now, but your matter is seriously being looked into, and you guys do not need to be in any anxiety. You know, your temple will continue to stay open. And surely, a couple of years later, it was announced, and it was in the 11th year, that they gave us a time limit. They told us to buy the land that was existing behind our grounds. It was 80 acres of land, and we got it for £1.2 million, which was very cheap at that time, and still very, very useful, and you know, great asset for Bhaktivedanta Manor to have. We were given 3 months to build the road, to get the permission, to get the money, to buy the land, and to build the road. And it seemed inconceivable, because normally it takes 6 weeks to get a planning permission. But the devotees were very intelligent. We knew in-house what was happening. So the minute we got that letter from the government's office, our architects headed for the development authority's office. And within a few days, we had that permission. At the same time, there was another group which was already ready to buy the land. In one night, in one session, we raised £1.2 million, just in one night. And then in the next few days, we were able to buy the property. We had the property, we had the permission, we built the road. However, the local government was still very upset because the central government had overruled their plans. So they put one more last hurdle. They say, and this is so funny, they said, you are in what's called a double green belt area. So the road you have built is got black tarmac. It should have a green surface. So all we had to do is get our spray guns and spray the tarmac green. And the road was done. And again, it was very interesting that the night that we raised funds, about 20-25 people were invited, well-to-do people, and they were invited by, you know, our steering committee. And one of the person who had turned up that evening, he was an Irish gentleman who had never heard of Krishna, had nothing to do with, you know, ISKCON. But he came because he was with his business partner. His business partner said, well, why don't you come along? So he came along. When we went around the table, we had raised £1 million. We were still short of £200,000. He was so impressed, he got up and said, I will give the £200,000. See how Krishna works in mysterious ways. Have faith. Have faith in Srila Prabhupada and his teachings. You go a long, long way. You know? Regarding anger mostly comes due to our false ego and ignorance. So sometimes we get angry towards our friends, towards our parents, our children, our management authority, you know, because because we don't get what we want, right? Normally, this is how I want to do it, right? Like I may go to Panchakota and say, I need 10 cars now. And he may say, well, I'll give you 2 to start off with. I should not get upset. I should say, okay, I will start with 2 and I'll endeavor and I'll prove that I deserve 10 cars. But because I don't get the 10 cars in one shot, I know in my mind I can employ 66, you know, Namata devotees, and 10 cars are going to be less. But I should accept authority. Prabhupada said that temple presidents is the final authority in the temples. And we should follow. What happens is because of the ego in our different circumstances, you know, we fall into the mode of ignorance. You know, in the second chapter of Bhagavad Gita, it's explained here. It says that while contemplating on objects of senses, you know, I want this, I want that, a person develops attachment for them. You know, we become attached to our desires, our thinking. And at that time, we are not able to hear the other side. And from such attachment, lust develops, and from lust, anger arises. So this is where the anger comes from, because we have lusty desires. You know? And then he says, Krodad bhavati samoha, samoha smriti vi brahma, smriti brahmasad buddhi naso, buddhi nasat pranasyati. So this answers the second part. why we are not able to come out. It says, from anger, complete delusion arises. Right? You're completely bewildered now. And from delusion, bewilderment of memory. When memory is bewildered, intelligence is lost. And when intelligence is lost, one falls down again in the material pool. See, it's a chain that drags you down into the deepest regions of modes of ignorance. And at that stage, no matter who's saying what to you, it will not be appealing because you have already drowned down so much. So, in the rare exceptional cases like Hiranyakasipu, because his brother was killed, to some extent it was understandable that he wanted to take revenge. But Prabhupada explains that in most cases, most general cases, for a little while there is enmity, for a little while there is this ignorance, and for a little while, there is conflict. But normally, through proper interaction and through sravanam, proper sravanam, try to understanding the situation and how to resolve the conflict, we can actually resolve this this enmity or anger against each other. No? And I give you a simple example. It's not exactly an example of anger, but it's a conflict resolution example. A mother has two children, a daughter and a son, who comes and there is only one orange, for example. There is only one orange and both of them want it. What would you normally do? As parents, you would say, okay, slice it into half, you take one half, you take the other half. But what do you do when both the children want the entire orange? I want the orange, and she says, I want the orange. I don't want half the orange. So the intelligent thing that a mother would do is would ask, why do you want the orange? And then why do you want the orange, right? Let's see. Try and understand who deserves the orange better. But to mother's surprise, one child wants the orange because she has homework to do and she needs the peel of the orange. And the other child just wants to eat the orange. Sravanam. You heard both the parties. You worked it out and you give the pills to one and you give the orange to the other. And conflict resolved. Right? So when there is anger, and anger is normally between two groups or two devotees or two individuals. So it's very important to hear them out. Normally in my management situation, I used to do is I'd ask them, okay, so Prabhu, why are you feeling like this? And then Prabhu number two, why are you feeling like this? And then ask Prabhu number one, what is the solution? And ask Prabhu number two, what is the solution? And then I say, okay, now both of you go away and find a solution, come back to me. And 99% of the time it works because initially it's ego clash. But when you calm them down and you bring them to the level where they are able to talk to each other normally, then you find a resolution. Question? I hope I answered part of your question. Yeah. His motive was to be King Indra. He wanted King Vyasasam. No? That was his motivation. But he knew that in order to get that, he would have to perform so many yagyas, 100 yagyas, right? So he was religiously following the principles. He knew that he had to follow. He was doing that purposefully because he wanted Lord Vishnu on his side also. No? And in doing so, and following the religious principles, as opposed to previously what he was doing, fighting, killing, hurting, all that. And he was lucky that he died and his guru was able to bring him back to life, right? So he came to a realization that he can die also as much as he can kill others. So now he wants interposition and he's thinking, this is a smarter way to do it. Right? So when he's on the 99th yagya, then Lord Vishnu comes. And by that time, he's performed so much religious principles, followed religious principles, he's performed so many yagyas, so obviously he's got so much benefit. Yudhishthira Maharaj performed one yagya and became a Chakravarti Raja. This guy is a 99. He wants to be the king of the universe. Prabhupada explains that the whole universe is also a very special body, you know, but even that body comes to an end. When this pralay, the entire body has to be diminished. So then what to speak of us as individuals, you know? So we should, if you look at it from that angle, we know one day it's going to be half a breath. Full breath will not be there anymore. So better to prepare for that, you know? Better to chant the holy name and go in that direction. Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare. Hare Ram, 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 Hare. Grantra Srimad Bhagavatam ki Srila Prabhupada ki jaya.